Welcome to a special Hanukkah edition of the Essay Arts Showcase. So we have a great program for you today. I hope that we can light up your day. Get it? And thank you so much for being here. Thank you for supporting your friends and your faculty members. We're gonna get things started. We're ready. Are you ready? We're ready. Okay. First up, singing From the Start by Lau Fei is Ella Hecht, Boaz Siegel, and Karenna Klein.
Don't you notice how I get quiet when there's no one else around? Me and you in awkward silence. Don't you dare look at me that way. I don't need reminders of how you don't feel the same. Oh, the burning pain. Listening to you harp on about some new soulmate. She's so perfect, blah, blah, blah. How I wish you'll wake up one day. Run to me, confess your love. At least just let me say that when I talk to you, oh, Cupid walks right through and shoots an arrow through my heart. And I sound like a loon, but don't you feel it to confess I loved you from the start. Ba da ba da da ba da ba da 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 ba 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 da 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 ba ba da ba da ba da ba da ba da. What's a girl to do? Lying on my bed, staring into the blue. Unrequited, terrifying. Love is driving me a bit insane. Had to get this off my chest. I'm telling you today that when I talk to you, oh, Cupid walks right through and shoots an arrow through my heart. And I sound like a loon, but don't you feel it to confess I loved you from the start. Confess I loved you just thinking of you. I know I loved you from the start.
Thank you very much. Hello. Thank you very much. Okay. We're going to keep it moving. If you just came in, thank you so much. Please try and keep it down. So next up, with some beautiful digital art, we have T. Maslow.
Hi. Is it? Is this working? Okay. Hi, hello. I'm going to go fast because I have a lot of stuff, but I'm going to try to enunciate. So I do art all the time. I do it digitally, and I do both stuff in black and white for comics, so that's just lines, and I also do full renders, which is stuff that is more painted and looks like it's painted, and I'll get into explaining more stuff. So next slide. Okay. First up, I want to talk about how I get ideas. Both of these are more recent stuff that I just kind of did. The first one on the left is something I did in art, which was to draw a house that, like, represents you. So that's kind of what I did. I just kind of, like,
put stuff together, and that was kind of the vibe I was feeling. The second one is I drew because I had a dream that had this character in it, so I wanted to draw that character. And mostly once I get ideas to, like, the process I go through is I first start where I make a thumbnail, which is, like, a very small, tiny version of the sketch, and then I blow it up and go from there. Next slide. So next I want to talk about rendering, which is basically once I have a sketch after I made the thumbnail and I go over with the sketch or, like, whatever finalized sketch I have, after I do the color, instead of, like, keeping it there and doing, like, some cartoon style where there's black lines, I go over whatever lines I have to make it look like it's painted so that there's no lines, and that's how you get the lineless style. It's very annoying, and I only recently have figured it out how to do it. It takes a long time. Usually the way what it requires is some understanding of lighting, so that comes in with... I have a very minimal understanding of that, but on digitally, there's something called a gradient map, which basically does it for you, where it separates it into a light color and a dark color for their shadows and lighting. Next slide. Okay, so for comics, this is a page that I recently did in black and white for a very large project that I'm having issues with, but that's another thing. And I basically do the same thing where I thumbnail it, where I make, like, small panels to figure out where all the panels are, as well as writing out what dialogue I want, if there is dialogue. The other one is a page, is a chapter cover without the text from my webcomic. Next slide, I want to go fast. Okay, so this is a bunch of traditional stuff of character sketches that I've done when I'm working on how to figure out how to draw characters and character ideas that I have. So usually what happens when I have an idea for a character, an idea for where a character fits into a story, usually the character comes first before their design. So they have, like, a placeholder model in my head where they're taken up by a character that already exists in media, and that's because that has, like, a similar personality to them. And then I start looking for, like, inspirations and research for what I want the character to look like. So when I do that, depending on what I'm drawing, but usually I try to keep the designs, like, realistic, as in it feels like something that the character would wear, but I also want to make it look fancy and, like, be able to be distinctive and recognizable, which also shows up in the characters' faces, which is also something that a lot of, or I've had trouble with art in the past and, like, have been working on, which is, like, same face syndrome, which is making sure that characters look different within their faces and they don't all have the same face. And basically the way I do that is, the way my style works is that I found a way to make it very stylistic while also kind of looking realistic. So what I have is basically have a compendium, basically, in my head of different facial features. So, like, what round eyes look like, what small eyes look like, what larger noses look like, what pointy noses look like, and the way I, like, cobble that art together to make unique faces without having to, like, do things from scratch all the time. And that's kind of it. Usually I spend, like, quite a bit of time working on characters. I also usually, yeah. And I do a lot of that.
Thank you, T. Very interesting to hear about that process. Yeah, another round of applause. Yeah, we can do that. Okay, switching it up a little bit, switching gears. We have Gavotte Opus 23, number 2, by David Popper, played by Charlotte Filer and Dr. Steinberg. Thank you. And I love those faculty-student collaborations. Thank you so much. Yes. Okay, switching it up. Presenting some watercolors, we have Nava Pollack.
Hello everyone, I'm Nava Pollack, I'm in 10th grade, and I love doing art in all its forms, but today I'm gonna be focusing on visual art, specifically watercolors, which I've been focusing on the past 3 years. This first piece is called Look for Help in the Mountains. It's inspired by Psalm 21, Tehillim, where we learn that our help will come from the one that makes the heavens and the earth. And so we should look towards the mountains. Like it's the clearest separation between, you know, the sky, and it's just very spiritual for me, like looking at mountains. And I have painted a lot of mountains, and this one I did it like a little bit more like out of focus style, so that it looked like when you stare at something for so long that it barely looks real anymore. And I tried to like capture some of that like dreamy feeling. Next slide. Now this painting is called Wilderlands. It depicts a like wide, unkempt field where the rolling rows of crops almost look like waves. I love it. The trees fade into the horizon, and like the sky almost looks like stained glass. It's so whimsical, and it's like another example of like the perfect imperfectness of nature. That's like really spiritual for me. Next slide. This painting is called Frond Fruit. I don't usually paint still objects, but I really liked how this coconut turned out. I used a technique called underpainting, where you paint under like most of your image with a specific color so that it like unifies and adds depth to the painting. I used like a light purple underneath the shell to make it look a little rounder. I don't know, and then it like matches more with the inside of the coconut meat. Next slide. This painting is called Stones of Coldplay. It's a painting of Yellowstone National Park. I've personally never been there, but I would love to. A friend of mine shared pictures, beautiful pictures from her trip, and told me that I have to paint one. And I did multiple times, and this was my favorite of how that turned out. Now these two, go back to the last one. Now, all four of those, if you may or may not have noticed, they all had the exact same color palette. Now, I don't always use the same colors, but those colors look really nice together, and like in a set, it's kind of cool to have something signature where they all kind of match, even though they're all different things. Next one. These paintings, they are named Bessie, the cow, and Wilbur, the pig, obviously. And like I had never really painted animals before like 2 weeks ago, and I started doing it, and it turned out really nice, and they were really, really fun. I had so much fun painting them. I like threw paint at these things. They were really, really fun, and they turned out so cute. Thank you.
Thank you, Nava. Yes. Okay, now with a few different styles of painting, we have Bethany Barakova.
Hi everyone, my name is Bethany Barakova. As a passionate artist, I have created several pieces ranging from realism to impressionism, with every brushstroke highlighting my perspectives. Art for me is not just a medium of expression, but a way through which I articulate my innermost self. Today, I am excited to showcase three of my favorite pieces, each a testament of my artistic exploration. So this is the first piece. It's called Summer Dining. It's crafted with gouache paint and showcases a collection of objects that were found throughout my house. This inspiration behind this piece draws from the vibrant still lifes of Vincent van Gogh, particularly his work with sunflowers, which evokes a sense of summer. The lively colors in this piece serve as a personal reminder of the warmth and dining experience during the summertime. Okay, so the second piece is called My Furry Friend. So it's painted with acrylic paint, captures a portrait of my dog and me. So I was motivated to improve my skills in depicting faces, so I attempted to do portraiture. departing from my usual focus in still lifes. So with the guidance of my art classes, I better understand facial proportions with a variety of colors that capture our skin tones. Overall, I'm very pleased with the result and plan to paint other portraits in the future. Okay. The last one is called A Garden View. This one is a pointillism piece, and it shows a house surrounded by a garden of flowers and trees with the landscape stretching into the background. This piece is inspired by George Seurat, who was famous for his pointillist painting similar to my piece, painting hundreds of contrasting color dots onto the work surface, a complete picture emerges. Thank you.
Thank you, Bethany.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Ms. Edelman. I'm the faculty advisor for our Poetry Slam team, and last week we hosted the Yeshiva Poetry Society's first Poetry Slam of the year, and two of our students won the grand prize and the runner-up. This was a very special Poetry Slam because it really was focused on Israel as the topic. And it was a really, really great experience to have, first of all, poets be able to have a space to share their thoughts and feelings in a medium that they love, in poetry, and also just to get together, certainly after COVID, to actually reinvigorate the Poetry Slam. So we challenged the kids. They had to do one poem in a form. So the form we chose is called a villanelle. And the second was just a free verse poem. The free verse poem had to be on the topic of Israel, and the villanelle had to be on the topic of hope. I'm gonna call up Noah Weiss, our champion, to read his free verse poem. There are no birds left in the sky.
I will always love the birds, from the cormorants and the cuckoos to the orioles and the hoopoes. From the blue ashy drongo soaring up above to the frigate bird, red belly of love. It was on those birds' wings that my hope used to fly, but no longer, for there are no birds left in the sky. No longer do I fall asleep in bed to the sounds of a curlew on high, but now I sleep in a cell. The sirens call my lullaby. No longer can I frolic free, admiring the morning dove, but now I sit constrained to the ugly sky, an empty glove. There are no birds left in the sky. Oh please, just tell me why. Why must the soft flap of wings disappear? Why must hope's cries not be the chirp of summer year? And why do they dance and cheer? Like this is some movie, like this is some premiere. I'm a hostage. No people, no song, but utterly alone. Arabic surrounds me, and I long for Hebrew. And home.
Okay, and next we have Jed Sultanic, Hope's Manipulation. Come on up, Jed.
Hope is a curse. Dressed as a blessing, in her beautiful blouse which billows out as she lulls confidence with a slight caressing. A limited oasis where death is pressing is simply illusion in the land of drought. For hope is a curse dressed as a blessing. Alpus only appears in times that are distressing, force-feeding flowers with a fiery shout as she lulls confidence with a sly caressing. Fireworks wonders when all is depressing, only to be doused down by a later bout. The hope is a curse dressed as a blessing. When she is around, there is no guessing. There's no need to fear the flautist of doubt as she hums confidence with a sly caressing. Hope is a jester that loves messing, distracting with flashing knives thrown about. The hope is a curse just as a blessing, as she hums consequence with a sly cursing.
Thank you so much. That was really moving, really beautiful. Okay, next up, we have our artist in residence. If you don't know her, some of you may know her from her time here at SAR, the lovely and talented Alana Litigoster.
Hello. As Reed said, I'm Alana Litigoster. I graduated from SAR in 2012. As then with now, I was and am an illustrator. I currently work in an online publication as their own artist in residence, I guess. But today I'm going to focus on my editorial artwork that I've done for Salon.com and otherwise. This first piece was for an article written by the talented Maggie Hennessy, who is a food journalist and restaurant critic, called Angry Cooking Mapo Tofu and Other Lessons to Learn in the Kitchen with Your Emotions. She realized she was ruining her food when she would cook it in anger, and we wanted to just portray that on website. So she relates her cooking style with how she feels about the social issues going around and how she ruined dinner for her and her husband one evening. Next slide, I guess. This next piece was for an article written by Chantrice Martin, an abolitionist and food advocate in Kentucky. She went on hunger strike when her local grocery stores seemed to be disproportionately providing produce between white neighborhoods and colored neighborhoods. And her son was in great distress seeing her slowly being weakened by the hunger strike as justice continued to not be served. Her article focuses on how she communicates that the world around her son was going to be not supportive sometimes, and how she wanted to be she wanted to be a calming and reassuring force in her son's life, but also wanted to protect him, but also knew she needed to be real about the difficulties that he might face in his life. This next one was for a piece a Mexican-American writer who, during the time, was facing some criticism by people who did not know who she was, that she had personal lived experience being an immigrant to the United States, and people telling her, you're culturally appropriating in your writing about your own experience. At the same time in the publishing industry, there were several books gaining popularity about Mexican American and Latinx experiences that were written by white authors, and they sort of had the financial and social push by publications that her and her contemporaries that came from these lived experiences were not being granted. And that's what this piece was hoping to sort of illustrate. This piece and the next one were part of a series for the organization Voices of Witness, which hopes to elevate the voices of minority groups. Especially during the beginnings of the COVID-19 pandemic, the series was for the unheard voices of the pandemic, which found several communities drowning in hospital bills, drowning in home bills, drowning in their situations due to both the isolation, loss of jobs, and just the overwhelming illness that was going around the country at the time. This one, while looking a bit crazy, had to do with the experience of the incarcerated during the pandemic. Sherrod McFarlane was in the Michigan State Prison and found that all of his social activities, anything that brought them any sense of normalcy was completely gone once everything started to go down. While they were already an isolated community of inmates, they were no longer allowed to have any form of socialization. They would be antagonized by guardmates and felt that there was just no hope in getting out of this and that they were forgotten and ignored by the rest of the world. Their communal activities, such as playing chess, exercising together, or even just being able to hold conversation, was completely taken out of their capabilities during this time. Anyway, that's the conclusion of those pieces. For this coming after break, we're going to start having artists in residence, which I am very delighted to be working with anyone who wants to join us. It'll be during activity period on Wednesdays. We're going to, like some of my editorial work has shown, focus on storytelling, how we visually represent either our own stories, other people's stories, or the things that we gravitate to. Some personal projects of my own that I am currently working on have to do with lesser known historical figures or figures in the Tanakh that I just find need a little more shine. And I hope you can join us with whatever style or medium you like to work with. Sorry, my voice is shaky. I am not good at speaking in front of people. But anyway, that's all. There's going to be a sign-up sheet for anyone interested. So, yes, harass Mr. Friedman.
Thank you so much. Looking forward to seeing what you guys come up with together. Okay, and last but not least, what, do you know who's coming? You know who's coming up? We have playing Alemán from the suite in D minor by George Frideric Handel. You know him, you love him, Mr. Zamir. Here. That is our show. Thank you to the administration, to the council. Thank you to all the participants. Thank you guys for being here. Have a great day.